again with the second lectures of Nicolas.
So good morning, everyone, and welcome to this second session on light scattering in disordered media. So the lecture today will be entirely devoted to the phenomenon of Anderson localization. So of course, Anderson localization is quite a topic now. And for this reason, in this lecture, I will essentially give you somehow an insight about this field. And as yesterday, whenever possible, I will focus on the case of optics. So before getting into this matter, let me give you a brief summary of the previous lecture. So yesterday, what I've shown you is that in a scattering sample, waves, and in particular light, propagate on average according to a diffusive motion. So precisely, we have derived a diffusion equation for the average intensity. And what I've told you is that this equation was essentially valid as long as the product of the wave number and the mean free path is much larger than one, something that I've called the weak disorder criterion. And then starting from this equation, we have calculated a very basic observable, the transmission coefficient of a scattering sample. And in a continuous beam experiment, I've shown you that the static transmission was decaying algebraically with the sample length, while in time resolve experiments, the time resolve transmission of a short pulse, for instance, decays algebraically at long times over a characteristic scale, TD, the Thouless time. And this Thouless time is typically the average residence time of the photons in the sample. In other words, it's the average time the photons need to traverse the sample by diffusion. And finally, we have studied a first interference correction to this diffusion equation, the coherent backscattering effect, which is an enhancement of the average intensity reflected at an interface with a scattering sample. And remember, I've told you that this mechanism was due to the constructive interference of two sequences, multiple scattering sequences traveled in opposite directions. So this is the outline of the second lecture. So today I will start by discussing another correction to the diffusion equation, which is called the weak localization correction. And this weak localization correction is important because it's actually, in a way, the building block, the interference building blocks of the broader phenomenon of Anderson localization. So weak localization is perturbative and Anderson localization is not. And then I will go to slightly more fundamental consideration and address two theoretical approaches of Anderson localization. The first one is the scaling theory, which has been developed in the early stages of localization. It's a phenomenological approach. And the other one is more microscopic. It's called the self-consistent theory of localization, which is actually only an approximate description of Anderson localization. It's not a theory. It cannot describe all the aspects of it, but still it works quite well. And in particular, it was pretty successful among the experimentalists in the last 20 years because they realized they could use the theory to explain their experiments. And I will show you a few examples. And finally, I'll conclude with the problem of Anderson localization of light in three dimensions, which surprisingly enough has not yet been observed experimentally despite many efforts. Okay, so let me start with a reminder. So yesterday I've told you from very general arguments that you can always, in a scattering sample, decompose the intensity over all the possible pairs of scattering path, I and j from a source to a detector at r. And formally, you can always split this multiple sum into two terms. You have a classical terms where the path from the source to the detector propagate along the an identical sequence, and what we have seen yesterday is that from this simple description we can derive the diffusion equation. Then you have all these interference terms, and yesterday I've essentially neglected these terms on average, saying that these phase shifts were making them very small as long as scale is large compared to 1. On the other hand, you may also ask the more precise question of the leading order contributions to this sum, to this average sum. And this question is actually well known. It has been studied a long time ago in the 60s. And these leading order corrections are known as the weak localization corrections. So they are shown here. And these corrections, they are leading order because they minimize the phase shift you can construct between the two paths. And the minimization is achieved by introducing here an interference crossing, an exchange of partners between the two paths. But as soon as you are introducing such a crossing, then if you don't want to introduce an extra dephasing, which would make this contribution smaller, you have no choice. You have to recombine the path after the crossing. So as you have to make them propagate along the same sequence, but then you have no choice. They must propagate in opposite directions. Of course, there can be an arbitrary number of events, again, in these loops. So the contributions of these loops has been calculated in many papers, actually. What was found is that the overall effect of this loop is not much, actually, in most common situation. Even when you have these contributions in the game, the diffusion equation is still overall valid, except for a small deviation from the classical diffusion coefficient, which I recall is the velocity, the speed of light times the mean free path. So the delta here really means here that this contribution is small here. This contribution, so this correction delta D is also negative. And it's negative, it's kind of intuitive because if you wish, because of these terms, now the diffusion process is a little bit slowed down because the wave spends some time performing these loops during their trajectories. I will not discuss too much the weak localization correction in the following because I would like to move on to Anderson localization, but just as a remark, it's a phenomenon which is routinely measured in mesoscopic physics. And the way people measure it is the following. They take a piece of dirty metal with many impurities. They measure the conductance. The conductance is proportional to the conductivity, which is proportional to the diffusion coefficient. And then they apply a magnetic field. The magnetic field imprints an Aronoff phase on these electron trajectories. And since the trajectories are traveled in opposite directions, you have a net non-zero phase appearing here. And then if you plot the conductance versus magnetic field, you have a certain value at zero magnetic field. And as you increase the magnetic field, you destroy these loops. So delta D goes to zero. And conductance increases because delta D is negative. So you have a differential measurement of the weak localization correction with an external dephasing, control dephasing. Okay, so this weak localization correction in mesoscopic physics, in general, it is small. And it's small not only because KL is much larger than 1, in fact, but also because these systems are finite. They have also a finite coherence. I would like you to do now with me, I will actually do it, is to calculate this weak localization loop, but in an idealized case, in the ideal case where the sample is of infinite size, in other words, in the thermodynamic limit and also perfectly coherent. And then we'll see what happens. So I will not calculate any diagram here, but just to show you that there is a very simple way of estimating this contribution. And the idea is to say that the change in the diffusion coefficient due to these loops is essentially governed by the probability for the particles to make such loops during the propagation. And if you adopt a very semi-classical picture where you see these diffusive trajectories as a sort of snakes, okay, sort of semi-classical tubes of cross-section lambda to the d minus 1, then the probability for making such loops is essentially the elementary volume spanned by this snake during dt, so it's lambda to the d minus 1 c dt, times the probability density of making a loop, and then we can integrate over all possible trajectory length up to infinity in the thermodynamic limit. You can have arbitrary long path. So of course the crucial element here is this guy, the probability density of making a loop, and for it we can just take the solution of the diffusion equation in infinite space with a source located at the position of the detector. And this solution is just 1 over 4 pi dBt to the d half. Okay? And then we have, just to calculate an integral over time, there is a small subtlety here. So because we are using this diffusive expression, for diffusion to be correct, you need at least one scattering event. There is no scattering at zero time. So in practice, you have to cut here the time at the scale of the mean free path. Well, this is not necessary. You could also take the full solution, which also applies at short scale, and then you wouldn't need a cutoff. So this is really a physical cutoff. So let's calculate this. Well, in dimension 3, so we integrate 1 over t to the 3 half, and the result is essentially square root of c over l, which with the prefactor here gives you a probability p loop on the order of 1 over kl square. And here we are very happy because we recover that when kl is much larger than 1, the contribution of these processes is 0. And in other words, the diffusion coefficient equals dB, the classical one, and this is exactly what we expect, of course. But now, in dimension 1 and 2, there's a big problem. The problem is that the integral is divergent at infinity. And here, it's a big embarrassment because we cannot regularize this physically. I have the right to consider the thermodynamic limit, and then the result is divergent. And in fact, this divergence is really physical. This is exactly what happens in a scattering sample in dimension 1 and 2. These mechanisms in the thermodynamic limits actually proliferate in such a way that in fact, the diffusion coefficient is no longer well defined, and what happens in this case is that the diffusion theory breaks down, and what comes up instead is called Anderson localization. Okay? So now the question is, what happens in practice if I do an experiment in 1D and 2D? So here's an example. That's an old experiment by Berry and Klein in the 90s, the late 90s. And what they have done here is to study the propagation of a continuous laser beam through a stack of glass slides with random separation. So this system is 1D. And they have simply measured the transmission coefficient as a function of the sample size. And what they measured is the following. These are the black dots. Did not observe an algebraic decay with the sample length. They observe an exponential decay of the transmission with the sample size over a certain scale, xi, which you have probably guessed is the localization length. So that's exactly what Anderson localization is about. It's an exponential decay of light transmission. So the transmission goes to zero in the thermodynamic limit. And if you would do an experiment of electron conduction, you would say that your sample becomes an insulator, an Anderson insulator. So just a few references here to point out that, of course, Anderson localization of light in 1D is routinely observed. It's not very difficult to observe. There are many papers about it in the literature, even more recent ones. Okay, so now from these observations, it's quite clear that the weak disorder criterion I discussed yesterday is in fact quite inaccurate, right? It's not sufficient to guarantee that you would have localization or diffusion. So for this reason, in particular, Towles in the 70s came up and introduced another criterion which was based on the spectral properties of a disordered systems, and in particular the sensitivity of the eigenstates of a scattering medium to a change in the boundary conditions. So for this, what Thouless did was to essentially make a classification of the eigenstates in a scattering medium. So on the one hand, you have the extended states, which are defined in a way that they cover the whole system volume, and in particular, they touch the boundaries. So if they touch the boundaries, it's clear that if you change the boundary conditions, for example, from periodic to antiperiodic, the state will change. On the other hand, you have the states which are confined in a small region of space, smaller than the sample length, and therefore these states will be quite insensitive to the boundary conditions. And just one example to show you that this is really what you get. So that's a numerical simulation that was performed by Dominique Delande, my colleague in Paris. So what he did was essentially to solve numerically the two-dimensional Schrödinger equation with in a 2D random potential. I think it was actually a speckled potential. And then he just calculated the eigenstates, the eigenenergies. Here you have an example of two different states. So the one on the right is clearly localized, the one on the left is extended. Of course, the spatial structure of these extended states can be quite complicated, but clearly it's extended, it touches the boundaries. So then the Thouless introduced to quantify this sensitivity to the eigenstates a dimensionless number, small g, as a ratio of two energy scales, small delta here, which is the typical change of the level as the boundary condition changes. So if you have level in a finite medium, you change the boundary conditions, the levels will fluctuate a little, and this fluctuation is delta, okay, qualitatively. And then you take the ratio of this delta E to big delta E, the mean level spacing, 1/ the density of states per unit volume times the volume. And then the Thouless criterion is the following. If G is much larger than 1, it means that as you change the boundary conditions, the levels will fluctuate a lot. In other words, they are associated, in principle, to states which are extended. They touch the boundary. And then in this regime, this is what Thouless calls the regime of diffusion. If you have extended state, you can support transport. On the other hand, if G is much smaller than 1, it means you change the boundary conditions, the level do not change at all, so the associated states are most probably localized, and that's what he called the localization regime, Anderson localization regime. Okay, so now what we would like is to calculate explicitly this small g in particular as a function of the size of the system. So there's a way to do that. And that's what I will show you now. And the strategy here consists in relating the spectral properties of a scattering medium with the transport properties. And to do this, imagine an experiment where you have a scattering sample of some size, and then you prepare inside a certain wave packet, psi of t, and then over, let's say, the expansion time of this packet, big T, you measure or calculate the spectrum of this wave packet, which is essentially this scalar product where psi of E is the Fourier transform of psi of T, but over a certain time window, okay, big T. Big T, which is typically the expansion time, so let's say you make an expansion from 0 to big T, and then during this time window, you measure the spectrum. So the wave packet can always be expanded on the basis of the Hamiltonian with levels and eigenstates, and then it's a matter of a few lines with Fourier transforms to get the spectrum. The spectrum is just a series of peaks which sample actually the levels, and if you measure the spectrum over a finite time, big T, then you have a precision essentially h bar over T, and that's how the things look like. Here you have, for example, a wave packet prepared in the middle of the sample, and here you have the spectrum which samples the levels with the precision h bar over T. Now suppose that you are looking at an expansion time smaller than the Thouless time. So let's say we have a diffusive material. So if T is much smaller than the Thouless time, by definition of the Thouless time we have seen yesterday, it means the wave packet has not reached the boundaries of the material. And if it has not reached the boundaries, then if you change the boundary conditions, nothing will happen, essentially. The spectrum of the wave packet will not change, okay? So when does it change? It changes when the wave packet touches the boundary condition, touches the boundaries, at the Thouless time. And when this happens, at this time, if you now play with the boundary conditions, if you change them from periodic to antiperiodic, for instance, then because the wave packet touched the boundaries, the spectrum starts to change. In other words, at the Thouless time, the spectrum starts to probe the fluctuations of the energy levels. In other words, the fluctuation, the typical fluctuations of the energy levels in a diffusive disordered material, it's h bar here over the Thouless time. So with this argument, we have connected the spectral properties of a medium with transport properties encoded in the Thouless time, and then of course we can calculate small g. So small g is then h bar, density of states, diffusion coefficient times L to the d minus 2, so the 2 is coming from Td, which is L square over dB, and the Ld is coming from the mean level spacing. And if you notice that L to the d minus 1 is nothing but the surface of the material, then you end up with the remarkable result that G is nothing but the Ohm's law, so it's the expression of the classical conductance in a dirty metal. Then, for this reason, actually, this small g, the Soleff number, is also called in practice the dimensionless conductance. So since g is the obeys the Ohm's law in the diffusive regime, by extrapolation, it's most likely that in the localization regime, remember, the transmission decays exponentially with the sample size, so the conductance with as well decay exponentially with the sample size. So now we have somehow a description of the diffusive regime, G much larger than 1, and the localization regime, G much smaller than 1. So now there's a question, what happens in between? And this question was addressed shortly after Thouless by in a very famous paper. So in this article there was Abrahams, the first author, Anderson, and two other gentlemen. And in this paper they formulated the question of what happens all the way from this regime to the other in the form of a scaling hypothesis. So that's really an hypothesis, it's not proven. And the hypothesis is the following: in a disordered medium, the Thouless number and the dimensionality are the only parameters which determine the change in energy levels as the system size is varied. So at a mathematical level, this essentially means that the log derivative of G with respect to the log derivative of the system size is a function of G and dimensionality only. And this is really not trivial. Just imagine that you are doing an experiment, you measure G by some technique, you calculate beta of G, or you measure beta of G, and then you plot it as a function of G. Imagine you're doing this, and then you change one parameter of your material. Let's say you change the mean free path, whatever. And then you calculate again G, beta of G, and plot beta of G as a function of G. There's no reason, a priori, that these two functions will be the same. Could be well that for one mean free path you will have a curve, and for another mean free path you will have another curve. So according to this article, this is not the case. It's a single parameter scaling hypothesis. And then there's a very important consequence, which is the following. If you now take these two limits, so in these two limits, beta of G actually in the diffusive regime equals D minus 2, in the localization regime, it equals log G. So you see that these two asymptotic limits actually satisfy this criterion. And then according to this statement, this is true all the way in between these two regimes. And then It means that in 1D and 2D, if you also assume the function to be continuous and monotonous, then by connecting the two regime, you get that beta is always negative. And that's very important. It's always negative. So whatever parameter you change on your system, it's always negative. In other words, in 1D and 2D, the G function is a decaying function of the sample size. In other words, in the thermodynamic limit, G will always be smaller than 1. In other words, in the thermodynamic limit, 1D and 2D system are necessarily localized. So you see that from very basic scaling arguments, there are hypotheses, of course, we recover here the same conclusion as the one we obtained previously by reasoning on the loops. So you can also play the same game in dimension 3. In dimension 3, now the extrapolation between the diffusive and localization regime implies that beta necessarily changes its sign. So this happens at a certain value, GC. So GC should be on the order of 1, according to the Thouless criterion. And if you're above GC, beta is positive, so the conductance increases with the system size, and therefore the system in the thermodynamic limit is necessarily diffusive. And here it's the opposite, beta is negative, so the system is necessarily localized in the thermodynamic limit. And if you're exactly at this point here, beta is negative, in other words, the conductance does not depend on the system size. In other words, we have here a scale invariance, and scale invariance typically means that you have a phase transition there, and this phase transition is called the Anderson transition, which occurs at GC, which is again on the order of 1, if we believe the Thouless criterion. Now you would like to know perhaps more precisely what condition should be fulfilled to observe this transition, for example. And actually, this can be found by a very simple argument, which is based on the scale invariant. So if you have scale invariance, it means that the dimensionless conductance here at the critical point essentially coincides with its value at the microscopic scale. Okay? And at the microscopic scale, let's say at a mean free path, clearly diffusion theory should be approximately valid, because to have this localization effect, you need to construct loops, so you need at least a few scattering events. So then if you just take the prediction of the Holmes law, evaluate it at this microscopic scale, what you get in three dimensions using the formula for the density of states, KL squared. In other words, in three dimension, we are just recovering that the Thouless criterion in 3D actually coincides with the regime of strong scattering where KL should be on the order of 1. So that's this condition which you should try to realize in practice to observe Anderson localization in three dimensions. Okay. So does this phenomenology work in practice now? Well, the answer is yes, actually. It has not been tested so much experimentally, quite surprisingly, but there have been many numerical works, and this is one example by Sergei Skipetrov and Igor Sokolov in 2014. So what they have considered here is just a three-dimensional cloud of two-level atoms, so classical dipoles. It turned out that in this system, so in a nutshell, the atoms coupled by light can actually be modeled by an effective Hamiltonian, which is called the Green's matrix. So the Green's matrix for a scalar light excitation. So I'm considering here a scalar light excitation. The Green's matrix takes this form and essentially describes here the propagation of light from one atom to the other. Because this system is open, the Hamiltonian is actually complex, so the real parts define the levels, the locations of the levels, the imaginary parts define the width of the level, and by computing all these widths for different system sizes, for example, for different cloud sizes, you can calculate the Thouless parameter, the beta function, and plot it versus peak R, and what you get is the following. And the single parameter scaling hypothesis is very well satisfied. In particular, you see here, if you change one parameter, say the atom number, all the points that you get for beta fall on the same single line. So we have indeed a single parameter scaling here. And notice in passing that the beta function vanishes here, which means that in this model system, there is a phase transition. Okay, so. No, you cannot do it in an experiment. I will discuss this case later, of course. Of course, this is really a model system. You cannot impose the light to be a scalar field.
You would call it acoustics, then it would be fine.
Yeah, well, in acoustics, you have also some different polarization states. It's still a bit different, but yes, I agree. Roughly, you could call it acoustics. So one word about experiments. So I've already mentioned these experiments in 1D, the transmission of laser through stacks of light. So there have been also experiments, similar experiments for microwaves propagating in waveguides, one-dimensional, quasi-one-dimensional waveguides, in particular in the groups of Andrei Shabanov, Azi Genak in New York. There was also works in 1D cavity in the group of Ulrich Kuhl, who was in Marburg in Germany at the time. And in 2007, there was also a first experimental observation that there were actually localized states present in microwave disordered cavities. So they just measured states in these systems. Alongside, in 2007 and 2008, Anderson localization of light was observed in random arrays of waveguides, in particular in a very important experiment in two dimensions here. So these two experiments actually are a little bit different from all the others in the sense that they are based on a very specific wave equation, which is the paraxial wave equation. And for reasons that will appear clearer tomorrow, I will really postpone the discussion to these experiments to tomorrow, to the last lecture. And finally, in three dimensions, as was suggested, there was an experiment of Anderson localization of acoustic waves in elastic networks reported in the group of John Page in Winnipeg in Canada in 2008. And that's in three dimensions, that's essentially it, actually. In particular, you have no here experiment on Anderson localization of light. I will, of course, come back to this problem, but a bit later in the lecture. So now that we have the global picture, what we would like to have at our disposal is a more, I would say, practical theory that would allow us to compute transport observables in practical cases. So it turns out that such a theory exists, and it can be found on the basis of the weak localization correction to the diffusion coefficient. So I remind you what I discussed in the beginning. So the weak localization correction is governed by the probability to make loops, the return probability in short, P of RR. And P of RR prime here is the solution of the diffusion equation. So this formulation of the weak localization correction is corresponds actually to a stationary problem. It's for zero frequency, so I integrate over time. It can also be generalized to finite frequency, and this will be useful to describe time-dependent problems in the following. And in that form, the generalization of the formula is essentially here. So that's the return probability, which is nothing but the integral in momentum space of the Fourier transform of the diffusion equation 1 over minus I omega plus dB Q square. So now, remember at this stage that what we are discussing here is perturbation theory. So in principle, this description should be valid so long as this term is small. So how to describe the regime of Anderson localization then? Well, there was a strategy proposed in the 80s in a series of very important papers by Vollard and Wölfle in Germany. And there, to make a very long story short, the idea of Vollard and Wölfle was actually pretty simple. The idea was to renormalize the diffusion coefficient in the weak localization correction itself. In other words, here, and here you have a dB which appears in the correction, which you renormalize as well. And the idea behind this procedure is that when you perform such a replacement, in fact, you account for a cumulative treatment of the loops, and the hope is that you will be able to capture the proliferation of interference at the onset of Anderson localization. So, of course, on paper, there's no reason that this approach is exact, and actually it's not. It does not capture all the features of Anderson localization, but it works quite well for many things, as I will show you in a minute. We have, so we could at this stage, of course, solve this this equation for d, and then we substitute this d in there and calculate p, and that's it. However, there's a little issue here. Actually, I've made a mistake here in this derivation. I've made a mistake in the case where we are looking at a finite sample. If you are in a finite sample, you have the translation invariance is broken. And if the translation invariance is broken, it means that the probability, the wave intensity to propagate from r to r prime is not the same as p of r minus r prime. In other words, p of rr is actually not the same as this translation invariant Fourier transform. In fact, in a finite system, I'm not allowed to use the Fourier transform at all. So the solution of this issue was solved in the 2000s, actually. And the answer to this problem is that you have no choice. If you are in a finite system, you can simply not use the Fourier transform. So you have to work in real space. So you calculate the return probability in real space, but since you have a breakdown of translation invariance, the return probability explicitly depends on R, and therefore you have no choice. The diffusion coefficient depends on R as well. And this is now the self-consistent theory with the renormalized diffusion coefficient here in the diffusion equation. So now at this stage you might say, okay, this seems that we are guided by the mathematics, but what is really the meaning of a diffusion, spatially dependent diffusion coefficient? The meaning is essentially the following. If you are of a finite system, so if you're in the bulk here, there is no problem. You have made, there's many space for these loops to develop. But if you are in the vicinity of the boundaries, the loops are cut. There's no space for them. And then you have a sort of inhomogeneity in the localization process, which is captured by these dependents. So that's more a technical problems, but it can be useful sometimes to keep this into account to describe fine details. So now this will be just applications. And as a first application, we can come back to the experiment by Berry and Klein and solve this self-consistent theory in one dimension. And it turned out that in one dimension, these equations can be solved almost analytically till the end. The trick is to use a very clever change of variable. So you go from x to the new variable tau of x, which is the integral of 1 over d of x prime, which you don't know at this stage, integrated from 0 to x. Okay. Then if you substitute this change of variable in this generalized diffusion equation, in the new variable you end up with a purely classical diffusion equation. In other words, we are back to the problem we already solved, where the transmission coefficient, I remind you, decays algebraically with tau of L here, okay? So we have done half of the job now. So what we need is, what we want is T as a function of L, so we need to get this function tau of L, and to get it, we have to use the second equation at our disposal, this one. So we can apply this change of variable to this equation and compute the tau of x function. And the result can be done. So I will skip a few lines here, but that's the result for tau of L as a function of L. So that's an implicit equation. Unfortunately, it has been solved numerically, but that's very easy. And the result can be solved in two asymptotic limits for large L and for small L. If you do it for small system sizes, what you recover is just mean free path over L. In other words, at short scales, you recover the law of diffusion, okay? Interference effect they have no time to develop. And if you look at the data by Berry and Klein, so there are, it seems that there are error bars which are within the dots. So it seems that actually indeed for a short number of slides here, this curve, which corresponds to this law, is approximately verified. On the other hand, at large length, this formula gives you t decaying exponentially with big L, so that we recover here Anderson localization. And this result is actually exact. And in particular, for the same price, you have the expression of the localization length, which is 1d, is on the order of 2 times the mean free path. And this expression is exact. So we can also use the very same approach to revisit the problem of the transmission of short pulses. So in this case, you have to keep track of the frequency and then do a Fourier transform with respect to it. So now the problem can actually only be solved numerically. So this has been done some years ago. And here I summarize really the main results. So what you find in three dimensions, when KL is larger than one, the time resolved transmission decays algebraically with the Thouless time. So that's exactly what we obtained yesterday, starting from the diffusion equation. And on the other end, when KL is smaller than one, this exponential decay reduces to an algebraic decay. So there's a certain power here, which is not very important. What is important here is that now in the localization regime, it's much harder for the photons to cross the sample. Indeed, they spent much more time in the material during doing these loops. And then this explains why the decay now in time is much slower. So that's a bit different. That's a bit the opposite as compared to the stationary experiment. So that's why I'm stressing a little bit on this. So this was also observed experimentally. So that's this famous experiment in the group of John Page, who reported on Anderson localization of ultrasounds. Here you have essentially KL larger than one. So here KL is changed by changing the frequency. And for KL larger than one, you would observe an algebraic deviation, which is well captured by this theory. Okay, so the last topic I'd like to address now is Anderson localization of light in three dimensions. So this problem is actually an old topic. It has been discussed by Anderson himself in 85 in a famous paper on the theory of white paint. A bit later, a few years later, it was more precisely addressed by Sajiv John, who was a PhD student in Princeton at the time. He's now a professor in Toronto. What was quickly realized in this article is that due to the very nature of the wave equation, in fact, it's much harder in three dimensions to localize photons than massive particles like electrons, atoms, or polaritons, for example. And the reason is that if you make a very basic mapping, or not a mapping, just a comparison between the scalar Helmholtz equation and the Schrödinger equation, you immediately realize that the effective disordered potential for the photons is not just the permittivity fluctuations, it's also proportional to the square of the frequency here. And this means that you cannot hope trap the photons in the valleys of the potential, because if you decrease the energy, you will decrease the disordered potential as well. So you cannot localize the photons at low energies. With massive particles, actually, you can. You cannot localize the particles at high energies. So where can you localize the particles? Well, to check this, we can be a little bit more quantitative by considering a specific example. For example, a collection of spheres here of radius A, density rho, mean free path L equals 1 over rho sigma in the dilute limit, which is here questionable, but let's do that. So if we have spheres, the cross section here is a function of K, of the wave number in general. And for spheres, so it's a bit more complicated than two-level atoms, it looks like this. So at large K, you reach the limit of geometrical optics, where the cross-section goes to the geometrical cross-sections. At low K, you are in the famous regime of Rayleigh scattering, which explains the blue sky. So sigma is 1 over K to the fourth. And in between, you have a certain number of resonances, which are the mean resonances, so essentially the Gary modes of the sphere. And then if you apply the condition for Anderson localization in 3D, KL smaller than 1, equivalently K over rho smaller than sigma, according to this, and plot K over rho on the same graph as the cross section, you immediately find that indeed you cannot localize at low and high energies, but there might be some window here. Maybe there will be many energy windows, but in general, you have to target at such a window in the vicinity of a resonance. Okay, so that's what people tried. Here's an attempt in the group of Adlag and Dijk in the Netherlands in the late 90s. So they use a strongly scattering sample to make KL as small as possible, which they illuminated in the vicinity of a mean resonance. They measured the transmission, and upon decreasing KL, they found something resembling a deviation from the law of diffusion. But these results were actually questions and criticized for very simple reason, which is that in 3D, you need, typically in this experiment, you have a very thick sample, so the optical thickness is large, and when the optical thickness is large, there is a very strong probability that the photons are absorbed. And here it's really real absorption. They're absorbed and they just disappear, okay? And of course, so it's not scattering, it's not re-emission afterwards. And then if you have absorption, if you lose photons, then of course there's an exponential decay in the transmission, but this has nothing to do with Anderson localization, it's just loss. And in fact, in these samples, which are pretty thick, there's no way to distinguish localization from absorption, and in turn, these results here, which were attributed to localization, were shown to be completely explicable in terms of purely classical diffusion theory with absorption included.
Don't you need a very monodisperse powder to target the resonance?
Yes, yes, and they pay attention to that in general. This one I don't remember. So I don't remember if this was is they paid attention to that. But in other experiment, they made many samples, then they do a microscopy and they select the monodisperse samples. So how can we do then? So people quickly decided to move to time resolve experiment, the transmission of pulses. And what is interesting here is that if you now transmit pulses, as I said before, now in the localization regime, the time result transmission decays algebraically. That's the signature of localization of the photons. Whereas absorption that just brings an exponential decay. So now you're happy, you can, in principle, distinguish between absorption and localization. Okay, so that was the strategy. And indeed, in 2006 and 2013, in these titanium dioxide powders, the deviation of the theory of diffusion was observed in certain samples, highly scattering samples, and this was again attributed to Anderson localization. But unfortunately, again, there was a disappointment, and there were many comments and discussions in conferences, and actually after Sometimes even the authors themselves realized that there was no Anderson localization in their samples, and I have to say that they made a very careful analysis of their samples afterwards, a very careful one, and they really characterized well the samples to demonstrate this. And the reason, the problem was here that these samples, at least some of them, they were displaying fluorescence. So what is fluorescence? In fluorescence, what happens is that your photons are absorbed, and then they can be re-emitted, but they are re-emitted with like a broad dispersion of delay times in general, with a strong delay, and also with a different frequency. So this is a sort of inelastic scattering process, and if you have a distribution of delay time, which is of course not described in all the theory I have discussed so far, then you have also a deviation observable. But what they notice is just by filtering around the incident frequency, actually this deviation disappears, and there's no, therefore, Anderson localization in there. Yes? Yes? Yeah, it's 1 over t to the power of s, yes. So s is just, it's just a number which was evaluated numerically, so there's no analytic prediction, it's something like 1.85, but I don't think there is any prediction for it. So in general, people, as soon as they see a deviation from exponential decay, usually they're happy, or sometimes too much happy. Sorry? So you have also to make, strictly speaking, this result is for delta pulse, so if you have a certain pulse shape, you have to make convolution with it. Okay, and the story was eventually completed by Sergei Skipetrov and Sokolov in 2014. There were also subsequent numerical simulations in the group of Robin Kayser a bit later. And what they have done, so this was a numerical work, and what they have done here, they reconsidered, so this 3D cloud of atoms, but as Antoine suggested, here they really took into account the full vectorial nature of the Green's function, of the Green's tensor. In other words, they did not make a scalar approximation for the light propagation. Again, they recorded the level width, the mode spacing, they computed the beta function, and what they found is that in this case, while the scaling, the single parameter scaling hypothesis is still verified, the beta function is always was always positive in that case. In other words, the G parameter increases with the system size. In other words, there's no Anderson localization at all in this system. So that's for a system of point dipole, and the conclusion that we have now is that it's not possible to localize photons in systems of point dipoles. Okay, so that's the fact. And now people try to understand why, so there's no theory available yet that explain this absence of Anderson localization. There's a very basic qualitative answer, which is that in three dimensions, actually this KL on the order of one, if L is one over rho sigma, and if you excite dipoles at resonance, sigma is lambda square. We have seen this derivation several times before. And then this condition is essentially equivalent to rho k minus 3 on the order of 1. And this is the regime where the sample is very dense, so the atoms are very close to each other. And in particular, you can have a static dipole-dipole interaction between the short-range dipole-dipole interactions between the atoms. And then you can actually carry energy through the system in this way. But it's not a radiative propagation. And all the description I have discussed so far, there is an assumption at some point that when you describe the Green's function, you take into account only the radiative part. So there's probably a lot of theoretical work to do in this context. So I will now conclude. This is just a summary. So I've shown you that generically waves are localized in 1D and 2D disordered media in the thermodynamic limit. In 3D, there's a generically a phase transition between diffusion and localization, and this phase transition has been observed for acoustic waves. So tomorrow I will tell you more about it in the context of ultra-cold atom experiments. And localization of light has been observed experimentally in 1D and 2D, but not yet in 3D. Thank you very much. There was, at the time, a community working while doing some quantum optics in scattering media. And, there are different things. So you can, for example, decide just to quantize the light field. But then if you do this, let's say if you have a scattering material that you still describe classically, let's say with a transmission matrix, then if you just quantize the electromagnetic field, the output field, quantized field, will be related to the input field by a transmission matrix. And the transmission matrix, which is treated semi-classically, contains already all the effect of Anderson localization at the classical level. So the fact of just quantifying the light and not the properties of the material usually does not bring anything new. Now you can really treat, so there are I've never seen anyone treating the full problem of the scattering medium quantum mechanically from the very beginning. I know that there were works at the time with a disordered array of beam splitters. So you can build up an array of beam splitters with a random transmission, for example, not 50-50 for each beam splitter, but a random number. And then you can send single photons and make them propagate, and then you have what is called a quantum walk inside the sample, and then you can calculate correlations, photo counting, statistics, things like that. And there are many works in this direction in Israel in particular, at Technion. That's not the same. I have not discussed this, but tomorrow I will discuss ultra cold atom experiments. Actually, this will be so be patient. Talking about the total electromagnetic energy that you would be stored somehow in the atoms or something like this.
Does it enhance this loop
probability? Well, the problem is that usually people don't know at all this quantity. So knowing that the question would be more, can we enhance the energy stored in a sample by changing the transport properties. I would more formulate it in this way. And I don't know, actually, I don't know what is the most advantageous from this point of view. Maybe it turns out that in the localization regime, if you excite a disordered sample with a very specific wavefront, so by doing the wavefront shaping, actually you can excite specific modes which are really really radiative in the material. So then maybe using this kind of trick, so shaping the wavefront so to maximize the energy of localized modes, you could enhance the energy stored.